Shed his battle fatigues for a coat and tie. That's because the MILF's fight has moved to a different arena. This time, the once feared former head of the Bangsa Moro Islamic Armed Forces, the MILF's military arm, has to employ diplomatic skills as a statesman as he navigates the government bureaucracy to achieve a political settlement for the Bangsa Moro people. His quest of a lifetime. We present to you part two of our profile of Chairman Al-Haj Murad Ibrahim. It was the first book he learned to read.
My father is a teacher in Quran reading. He's a teacher.
Before my being in the elementary school, I have already completed reading the whole Quran with my father.
In contrast, Murad's two sons had only toy guns to play with when they were growing up. That's because he raised a family when fighting was at its fiercest in the mid to late 70s.
At that time, did you think that, you know, what kind of future your children would have?
I always believed that what we are doing, what we are doing is for them. So even if we feel that they have been suffering with us and they have to sacrifice their studies at times, but then we console ourselves that what we are doing is an obligation, and what we are doing is not for us, but for them, for their future. My eldest son, because he was born at the height of the fighting, so I have to bring him with us in the jungle. And so he learned. He do not have toys. What he has is
a gun.
a toy gun. It's not a real gun, but because he see everybody holding guns, so he do not want other toys. He want a toy gun.
Hopefully, time will come when children will no longer have to be raised that way. No?
I'm afraid that if we fail, then the next generation will be more militant and more. Because they are exposed to the violence. All their life they have been exposed to the violence. So I think it's time that we have to succeed.
It was Murad's eldest brother who eventually raised him.
I was orphaned very early. My mother died when I was just more than a year. More than 1 year old. My father died when I was 13. I studied on the support of my elder brother. At first, he doesn't also, because he was insisting that I have to finish first my studies before joining. But then I insisted, I said, I have to join now, because I see that the situation is becoming worse.
When he was in his early 20s, he found love in the battlefield in Haja Lupia Pasigan Ebrahim, a fellow revolutionary. As a Muslim, he could have had more than one wife, but Murad says he had only one other mistress, the Bangsa Moro struggle.
I married during the height of the struggle in 1974. So because my wife also is a revolutionary, and she is among the medical aiders at the time. So then from there on, maybe I'm more focused to the struggle than to marry another wife. So I maintain as my one wife. My youngest son was born at the height of fighting. So I have to send my wife down because she is already about to deliver. So they have to walk more than 10 kilometers.
Heavy with child.
We were in these jungles in between Lanao and Maguindanao area. So I sent her down, and she delivered her child prematurely.
What was the closest that you came to getting killed?
One time when I was hit at the back by a splinter, and then there was also a time when, together with my wife, we were walking, and then in between us, the mortar shell fell in between us.
Between the two
of us. But it's fortunate that the mortar shell, because it is in the marshland, it penetrated very deep, and the splinter was not very, did not spread very well, so we were safe. And there were many instances.
I'm sure you cannot count, no?
You cannot count. It's lucky. Become a part of a life. So.
It has been speculated Murad fought in the Soviet-Afghan conflict, which began in 1979 and ended in 1989. That eventually led to the birth of a more radical Muslim insurgent group, the Abu Sayyaf.
You had never yet really confirmed whether you fought in Afghanistan. Did you?
I visited Afghanistan. I just visited our men who were fighting in the frontier in Afghanistan. But myself, although I stayed there in the camp for quite 2 or 3 months in the camp, but I did not actually engage. It's our people, our men.
Murad justifies the MILF's ties to terrorist groups Jemaah-e-Islamiyah and Al-Qaeda.
The reality says is that, you know, during the time, at the time of war, when there is hostilities, there is there is no effective authority. And as such, any group can exist, can just mingle among the civilians and among people. And, you know, the MILF also, being not fully, not a full authority in the area, cannot effectively control. And the government also, likewise, have no control of the areas. So the chances of people other can just mingle with the population is always there. And added to that also, small groups who are fighting the government can exist because they can capitalize on the grievances of the people. You will notice that in every area, groups who are fighting the government, people sympathize with them because of their grievances. So if you remove the grievances of the people, then groups like Jamaa Islamiya and other group, and even revolutionaries, can no longer exist or cannot survive in areas where people doesn't sympathize with them.
It all boils down also to the question of whether the MILF can control these other groups that identify with you, but may necessarily stray, but may at times stray from your moderate thinking, like the BIFF. What are they?
The real challenge here is, will the MILF be able to influence these people to toe the line? You will, if you see the background of why the BIFF was formed, the so-called BIFF, it was more on their disgustment over the peace process, because in the first stage they were MILF, but because they feel that the peace negotiation is going nowhere. It has been more than 10 years and nothing has been achieved, especially when there was this MOA AD not signed officially. So they feel that the peace process is going nowhere. So that give them the capital to influence followers that we have to fight the government because this peace process have no hope.
Are you communicating with them?
Yeah, we are. We are communicating with them.
So Commander Bravo's support for the framework agreement was no surprise to you?
No, it's not a surprise, because he has been very supportive. We managed to let him understand that everything in the peace process is still not sure, and we have to hold on it until we finally achieve our objective.
And the same with the BIA. FF, you're confident that they would support this framework agreement?
Well, we are confident that if not all of them, most of them will be carried.
So no hostilities from these two groups?
As of the moment, we see that, and we are hoping that there will be no hostilities.
Next on People.
I'm now 64. It's more than 40 years.
Just my humble take on the news. My protest is failure to mention any statistic for foreign women coming here for sex, commercial or romantic. I think Marcos should be buried for what he was, a former president, twice elected in democratic elections. We don't want our president to suffer with us. We want him to stop our suffering. Seldom wrong, always right. I'm Teddy Loxin Jr. Here's what I think. The editorial on the world tonight.
President, Republic of the Philippines.
The breakthrough was made under a veil of secrecy when President Aquino traveled out of the country to meet with Murad for the first time. Camp Darapanan was considered as a venue, but the two eventually met in Tokyo 14 months ago.
How did that happen? How were you surprised that he reached out in that way?
Did not come as a surprise to us, because you will recall that even her mother, during her presidency, went to Sulu to meet Nur Miswari before forging any agreement. And so when he invited us for a meeting, initially Malacanang wants it to have it here in Mindanao. But we told them we will have a very big challenge of security arrangement. So finally, we have we have acceded to a meeting outside of the country, and they have also acceded on that. So that is where, but it came a surprise to everybody because there was no prior information about it.
It was the fulfillment of a promise made by the president's mother, Corazon Aquino, 25 years ago when she met with the MILF leader early into her administration.
She visited Cotabato. In the ARM, still in the Lupon Tagapagpaganap, there was the building there. So I agreed to discreetly go to Cotabato City and meet her. Then there was the General Assembly of the MILF here in Camp Darabanan in 1986. But then the peace talks did not prosper at that time.
The more flamboyant Nur Miswari overshadowed the leaders of the MILF. But in the end, the peace deal signed with Miswari's MNLF in 1996 failed to deliver.
There is an impasse on collective leadership, meaning it doesn't mean that I, as head of the Central Committee, can be equated to the MILF or any other leader of the MILF, because we always build up the image of the Central Committee as the governing body of the MILF. Unlike the MNLF, you will notice that it is always centered to Nur Miswari. So sometimes, even the OIC feel that the MNLF is equated to Miswari, because until now, the MNLF Central Committee, to be very frank, it is not functioning as the MILF Central Committee is functioning.
And now you have him attacking this agreement. So what do you tell him?
I always tell him that we should see the effort, both effort, your effort, our effort, the effort of the MNLF and the effort of the MILF as complementary. I always explain to him that it does not mean that we see that we have to throw away what you have achieved. But our objective is that we want to complement the 1996 peace agreement. But you know, Brother Noor is sometimes not very considerate of other ideas. So what is important is we continue to reach him.
There are still many items left to negotiate in the framework agreement. One of them is disarmament, as provided for in item 8.
If we can feel that the prevailing situation will be turned into a situation where people will no longer aspire for independence, people will no longer aspire to hold firearms, then it will be a matter of voluntarily giving up their firearms. So that's why even you will notice that there is this graduated decommissioning provided in the framework agreement. I have been emphasizing that our people, our men, did not join the struggle because they want to become soldiers. They joined because they believe in the aspiration of the struggle. So if they feel that the struggle have accomplished its objective, and they feel that there is no need for them to hold firearms, then they will voluntarily give up their firearms.
In the comprehensive agreement, they will be bound by certain dates. Will there be deadlines?
This has to be fleshed out yet, because this is part of the normalization process, and it will be a graduated process. And then as far as timetable is concerned, that has not been discussed yet.
There are less sticky items. Murad says the annex on revenue generation and wealth sharing is 80% complete. The government and the MILF panels meet again in Kuala Lumpur to hammer out the vital annexes.
What is asymmetrical? What does that mean, sir? The asymmetrical relationship between the Bangsa Moro and the national government?
There is a variation of the formation of the government with the national government. That is why we are also very, very clear that
it can have a different structure.
Yeah, it can have a different structure. That's why there is very clear that it is the government will be in ministerial form.
So explain to us, what does that mean?
In ministerial form, it varies from the presidential form of government. It will be more like a federal setup, although it cannot be equated outrightly to a federal state, because the Philippine government is a unitary system of government.
So there will be like a sort of federal system, but not quite.
It will not be permitted unless the constitution is amended. Then only then that we can permit a federal setup.
I mean, this will not require the constitution to be amended.
Well, that remains to be seen, because we will be after this we will be on the process of implementing the agreement. So the government panel have been saying that the agreement can be implemented even without amending the constitution. Well, for us, we still see that implementing the agreement in letter and spirit needs adjustment in the constitution.
Why? Which part?
There are provisions there which we feel that it cannot be accommodated unless there is a movement in this. But then we give chance to the GRP. They were saying that it can be implemented, so we can have even without changing the. But that remains to be seen.
A transition commission will be named soon in preparation for the Bangsa Moro entity that will replace the ARM. The commission will have 15 members, 7 selected by the government and 8 from the MILF. Its main task is to draft the Bangsa Moro Basic Law.
The Basic Law will be put to ratification by the people, and then after ratification, it will be entrenched in Congress, will be entrenched in the Constitution. So after that, the Transition Commission will cease to operate anymore. And then the next will be the Transition Authority.
It's a long process still.
Well, we are looking for a timetable of 2 years. Or not more than 2 years for the Transition Commission, and then at least 1 year for the Transition Authority until 2016 election.
If ever there will be a need to amend the Constitution, when should this happen? Before the Transition Authority?
I think it would be after the Basic Law is drafted.
You think the people will accept this?
We are quite confident that if the Basic Law will be based mainly on what we have as provided for, it will be generally based on all the agreements we have forged with the GRB, then we are very confident it will be accepted by the people, because we have been consulting our people for several years, have been continuously consulting them.
To what would you attribute this seemingly wider acceptance?
One thing that contributed is the series of advocacies conducted by both parties, the GRB and the MILF, and also we see a contribution of the popularity of the president. Also, on the other hand, the trust and confidence of our people to the MILF.
It is to the credit of the MILF that while the arm was marred in corruption, they strengthened their military and mass base to continue the struggle for the Bangsa Moros' unrealized dreams. Next on People.
It's continuous. My life is dedicated already to this struggle.
At his first press conference after the signing of the framework agreement, it was evident there was great international interest in the peace process.
What was your style of leadership?
Our general principle in the leadership is we abide with the teaching of Islam, that is consultative, collective and consultative. So everything has to be, every major decision has to be decided by the central committee and not by one or two persons only.
Have you been able to develop young leaders within the MILF?
Now, in the central committee, around two-thirds are already from among the young people. The old consists only of about one-third of the central committee.
What do you see for yourself as the future? I mean, what are your plans? When can you relax and, you know, stop being on the run?
Well, when everything is in place, the agreement has been in place, and then we are able to set up a real government and a society where people no longer fear for their life. People that are well off, no more evacuees and others, then I think only then we can relax and say everything is there in place, and it's time to retire.
But Murad concedes the challenges ahead are great as he adjusts the strategies he employed on the battlefield into the negotiating table.
The more you are subjected to more difficulties, then the more determination, because you will feel that if you give up the struggle, then all the sacrifices have been thrown away.
Even if it took so long, I mean, that you were 21.
Yeah, I was 21.
And you are now?
I am now 64. It's more than 40 years. More than 40 years. And from that time on, I never have normal life.
So you would say you haven't yet, you know, there's no time to rest for you.
Yeah, because it's continuous. My life is dedicated already to the struggle.
I'm Ses Orena-Drilon, and this is People on ANC.
We'll be right back.